start by saying it's an honor to be here with you. The 18th Annual African Conference, the theme of leadership and institutions. I think I had a very difficult task today because I've been told that I should be funny, polite, and entertaining. But I want to talk about politics, and I don't know how talking about politics can be. So, I'm going to share one of my stories today, because I have lots of stories. This story highlights the challenges and opportunities. What I think is one of the most important institutions in recruiting and training leaders in Nigeria, in Africa, which is the political party. So how did I become foolish enough to think that I could contest elections in Nigeria? I think I was guilty of a bit of arrogance and obviously a lot of naivety because I had no clue what it entailed to be a politician in Nigeria, to run for office in Nigeria. But you know, of course, when you have lots of dinner conversations and conferences like this, you come away thinking, how hard can it be? You know, we all talk, it all seems very rational and you know what you're supposed to do. So I decided to roll up my sleeves and join the House of Representatives in Abuja, which is the lower house for Parliament in Nigeria. We call it the National Assembly. So but why would I want to be a member of the House? The House is notoriously, it has a very bad reputation for one. Even though we're one of the highest federal legislators in the world, but that's not the problem. Legislators are also very abused, and they don't really have a very good reputation. But I still thought I might be able to make a difference. And it wasn't only because I find it hard to do things the easy way. So my friends tell me that when you want to do something, I usually choose the difficult route to do it. Some say I have punishment syndrome, which is really hard. Deliberately put yourself in harm's way. But that's one of the only reasons why I ran. I mean, I ran also because I had affirmative reasons. I wanted to make a difference, and I was tired of sitting and complaining. I had an interesting conversation on the bus coming in from Austin, Texas, after today's session with a professor from one of Nigeria. But we talked about how, you know, we have these conversations. How do you put that into practice? So this was me trying to put that into practice. This was me trying to move away from complaining all the time. And then the second reason I ran was because I wanted to see different people in politics. I wanted to see in Nigeria people that looked and sounded like me. What does that mean? I'm not anything special, but in Nigeria, I'm not the typical face of a politician. Mm-hmm. First of all, I'm female, so we need more women in Nigerian politics, obviously. Second, I just wanted, you know, somebody that reflected my values for a change, and seemed to be enlightened, seemed to understand that, you know, there's something called enlightened self-interest, that if I'm okay, everybody else will be okay. Yeah. If everybody else is okay, I will be okay as well. Just sort of give and take. Something that I wasn't seeing. And then the last reason was I also wanted to know. In Nigeria, we've had years and years of bad leadership, as we documented very eloquently by our senior writers like Chinua Achebe, Olusegun. We talk about it constantly. I'm sure all the Nigerians in this room can identify. Mm. So I wanted to know, beyond peer power talk, what it's like to run for office. So I started, and it was a very, very expensive education. And I wanted to, it was so expensive that I decided to make money from it. So I captured my experience in this book called Love Does Not Win Elections. And I'm going to share, even though usually I sell the book for $10, today I'll share bits of the book with you for free. So what were the five things that I learned? The very first one that I learned, for me the most important Eureka moment, was that by the day of election, the Nigerians are heading to the polls in another year or so, exactly a year actually. By the day of election, 80% of the battles of recent leadership has already been lost. Like, right now there's this rage to get your PVC, which is your voter's card. But the truth is, by the time we're lining up and casting our votes, we've already lost the battle. Because what we get from the parties are very limited choices. And so for me it was an eye-opener that I shouldn't be just excited about election day, but really what happened even before the election within the party. So what was the first thing that happened? So I was going to run, but I wasn't a member of any party, so I had to decide which party, to run for. And that was the very first eye-opener, because it's not easy to join a party in Nigeria. I don't know how it works here, I've never tried, but you know, you go online, it doesn't tell you what to do. You don't have any idea where your ward office is. There's no information. Like, literally, it's like looking for a needle in a haystack. So I used my contacts. I found somebody who knew somebody. APC. APC is the All Progressive Congress. So there's so many names now. Yeah, the All Progressive Congress is the winning party now. So I thought, okay, let me go to the new party. I went there a few times, but I couldn't join. I kept being given the runaround. Later on, I was told that I didn't speak their language. So I ended up with the PDP, but how did I happen? The PDP was ruling party then. This is 2014. So yes, PDP wasn't my natural choice because they had been leading finance well and been in power for a long time. But I went. Somebody said, I know the one chairman, I'll take you to see him. And it was in the evening, you know, we sat outside, he brought out this huge ledger, which had all these spaces in between it. And he's like, how far do you want to go? And you know, depending on how far you want to go, you know, that's what, how much you have to pay. That you had to be in the party for 2 years at least before you were eligible to run. So he was being wise. If I wanted to beat that criteria, he had to shoot my name as high as possible. And that's when I realized, like, why does your letter have all these blank spaces in it? It was to be able to accommodate people like me, who are last-minute members of the party. So I paid $17,000, which is In my journey to understand Nigerian politics, you know, people have shared their story when they go to, when they finally find these ward offices, which are the needles in the haystack, they get asked things like, who sent you? like literally, why do you want to join? They don't want you. They want a certain type of person to be in politics. They don't want people like me and you that speak a lot of English, that might ask a lot of uncomfortable questions. So that's another thing with the parties. And so if the parties don't want members, then they also don't want members who pay dues. If they don't want members who pay dues, that means they want to be able to control the party. This is where the party finances come. So all these things are things that make the choices that the parties give us not very helpful in our quest for development. So there are no recruitment drives and all that. So that was the first lesson. The second lesson I learned is that most of the parties practice the delegate system. And the delegate system, as practiced in Nigeria, is deeply flawed. I don't want to say the delegate system is flawed, because I'm sure it works in other industries. But in Nigeria, very weird. So I'm going to also tell a few stories about my delegates. So first of all, PDP had a rule that we have two types of delegates, ad hoc and automatic. And I won't bore you with the details, but I had to find 66 ad hoc delegates across my 22 wards. Now, there's no rhyme and reason to how delegates are selected. Literally, they just, the parties pick the delegates, even though they'll make you pay for forms. So I paid for a form for myself. I thought that I could be a delegate, so I could at least be sure of one vote. At least let me vote for myself. After all the millions I had paid to be, you know, to buy the nomination forms and things like that, all those things are very expensive and I had to pay for those. So it was just $30 to pay for my, you know, the delegate form. But we went for this board meeting when the board chairman asked us how many of us wanted to be delegates, and 14 of us put our hands up. It was meant to be only three. He said, okay, all noted, put your names on a piece of paper and we will come back to you and let you know which of you have succeeded. But whatever the case, don't worry, because whatever treasures come to these three people who are representing the world, we will all share as one happy family. That should have been a clue. I don't know why. Anyway, long story short, the conference ended. I wasn't part of the delegates. I was told that these were the three delegates of my ward. My ward chairman, Junie, handed over the details so I could contact them. But that still meant I needed to, find 63 other delegates. And trust me, the party wasn't useful because the primaries were December 6th. The official list of the delegates came out less than 24 hours before. So I should, yes, they have been told that don't even wait for the official list. Just find a way of finding your delegates. So finding your delegates is almost as hard as finding the party. But this time at least I started making progress. I knew the ward chairman. So through the ward chairman, I met with the delegates a few times. I hosted conversations like this and smaller ones. I went to them, they came to me, all that cost money. But what struck me about the delegates when I got to know them better was that, okay, my history is in the private sector. I think Dr. Ada read very nice pieces when I started my career just in the private sector. And I realized that many of these delegates I would be hard pressed to employ as anything other than, if I'm generous, maybe office assistant. Somebody who you would send out to just run errands. Yeah. But these were the people that the party wanted in as members. And these were the people who were going to delegate. And these were the people who were going to make the final decisions and were going to be all excited about the election. So that was another lesson, another eye-opener. And then we went to the primaries, and there were several things that, by now, I'm getting more seasoned. So I had been warned about the primaries and things to look out for. The first one was that many of my delegates could not write. Yeah, they can't write. And we're not going to be used, I'm not making this up. We're not going to use ballot papers. We're going to use strips of papers where they would write down the names of the candidates they wanted. So how was I going to ensure that my delegates could write the right name down? Well, the party said that that would be their decision. They would choose for the delegates who would write for them. So that was strike one. They were going to choose the ward chairman or the party chairman who was not in favor of me. There was a party candidate and it wasn't me. So if I couldn't even choose who was going to write for me, delegates who were interested in me, I'd already lost something. So that was one. The second strike was I had two main constituencies, Mwari and Amak, the AMP. And we had from our calculations and our strategy was still living in fancy life. I had a strategy. My strategy was that most of my delegates would come from Buhari, that's it. For different reasons. So they seemed to be the most disgruntled, most unhappy with the incumbent who the party wanted. So I had been told that make sure you don't have two separate ballot boxes, have only one. Because see, if you have separate ballot boxes, the parties can blackmail the Buhari delegates. So that when the votes are being counted, they find that they didn't vote for the person they had ordered them to vote for, they'll be held to pay. So we were busy, we the underdogs were busy fighting to have one ballot box so that it would be hard to say where the votes came from, whether it was Buhari or Amak, or we failed. So that was strike two. So we didn't get that. So those are the little things that made it clear that by the time the votes were counted, I wasn't going to be winning that. So I didn't win the primaries. There were four of us, and I'll let you read the book to find out how the votes were split amongst all of us. But so that for me, that was another eye-opener, that the delegate system is designed for capture. So even when we go through the charade of primaries, it's rigged, and it's designed to be rigged. And that's tied to the third thing I learned, that politics is an industry with an entire political economy that's reliant people like me running. they have to make money. They have to make money from selling the semblance that, you can run. Oh, yes, you will win. You know, they have to keep encouraging you, and that will get all that money. So, yes, it is. But so, if I was to. So, it's an industry that has barriers to entry is an industry that's very tightly close-knit, that has generations. You know, I met old men whose middle-aged sons were in the business, who were grooming their younger brothers to be in the business. A business. People, you know, the people in between election cycles, these people get jobs with like the incumbent who hire them as special assistants. You know, their ties, there's land ties, and because government is there, has so much power. And, you know, I heard threats of people's lands going to be revoked just if they didn't vote for the incumbent the way it was supposed to be. And then the fourth and most important lesson I learned was that money is key, but it's not everything. It really isn't. You know, for many Nigerians, we dismiss participating in politics because, and I'm sure maybe it's the same in many parts of Africa, and I mean, I hear about campaign financing even in, you know, in the US. So I know that being able to raise money is a very big issue, but money alone will not make you win. Even if I had the deepest pockets, I wouldn't have won the election because I was in the party campaign. And there are many, many stories in Nigeria, and I would just use MQ Abiola as an example. He was supposedly one of the richest men in Nigeria when he wanted to contest in 1983 for MP, and after being a financier of the party, he still couldn't win. And then he won in 1993, and they still couldn't give him the mandate. So it's not enough to have money. So for those who dream of dismantling the system, it's important to know that, and I was happy that I learned that lesson. So is my story typical or not? I mean, I can't say. I do know that some people say, yeah, but you are an imposter. They were right to reject you. You know, you did the equivalent of jumping over a wall and landing in their compound. You didn't go through the gate. You should have waited your turn. You should have joined the party 10 years ago. You know, all sorts of things they tell me. And I listen politely. But the truth is, even when people do it the right way, whatever that way is, still no chance they're going to win. There's no guarantee they're going to win because the process isn't fair. So I do take it personal. But I also don't let people tell me that my story isn't real or isn't representative of what Nigeria is or what our political system is. Yeah. And I'd like to use one last story before I round up. In 1979, the military were handing over, there were five parties, an NPN, the party that would win. And PDP today is considered to be the grandchild of NPN. So NPN had three major presidential candidates. Chiyo Shagari, Itamar Sule, and Adamu Chiwenga. And everybody thought Itamar Sule was the best candidate by far. He was articulate, he was vain, and people loved him. So for people who say, yeah, you don't have grassroots support, that's why you're winning, he had grassroots support. But he didn't win the primary because the party felt he would be the candidate they couldn't control. Because he would be the candidate that would change status quo, which is what our parties are not designed to do, which is what our politics is not designed for. So Itamar Sule didn't win. Instead, Shehu Shagari, whose only ambition really was to be in the Senate, was roped into being our president. And we've been having this series of mistakes and accidental winners till today, till the ones that we have. So my story is the story of Nigeria, and I wonder if it's also the story in many parts of Africa. I know that politics in Kenya and Sierra Leone and the way the parties are structured is very similar to what I experienced. So I wonder how many other countries face this. So when we talk about leadership, deficit of leadership in Africa, are we looking at the parties? We seem to talk in abstract. How many people belong to the parties? How many people in civil society are organizing around the parties? How many academics are studying our parties to see what their ethos is, to see what their culture is, to see what their focus is on, how they're recruiting? What the criteria for being a member of a party in any African party is. So we're not doing that. What I've seen is that our political parties are such that it's like a sausage making factory and it's never been one. But I imagine that everything you put into it will come out shaped. You know, and I like to imagine that anything you put through the political process will come out like that, which is why it's so hard to get decent people. We keep lamenting and lamenting. But everybody you put in there, bar a few, you know, deviants, the system is designed to just push you out. If you're not going to fit into the mold, it will just keep pushing you until it gets out what it wants. So for me, that was also very important to us. And I think it's something that we should spend more time thinking about. So we had brilliant analysis from Dr. Lau yesterday talking about institutions. action and processes. And I get, and the old, age-old, very popular comment of what speech would be about Africa would be complete without mentioning Obama. But Obama said, Africa doesn't need strong men, it needs strong institutions. But what builds institutions? Who builds the institutions? Are the institutions just built by spirits? Do we not need strong people to build those institutions? And will they just emerge from the ground? And if your institutions are designed to make sure that only weak men emerge, we're kind of screwed, aren't we? So for me, those are the things I'd like to leave us with. Just three questions. Are the political party structures the best that they can be? Should we applaud when one person, and I listen with admiration to the story of, I don't see her face in the audience, but somebody that I admired from afar, who said she ran when she was 30, and fantastic, But my sense of our political party is that it hasn't changed much. So should we applaud when one person manages to navigate the system as flawed and as dysfunctional as it is? Should we try to replace the system with something that's better and that will be fairer to all of us? And finally, what are the opportunities to change our parties? Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Well, first of all, my deepest gratitude to Professor Falola and Malabisola for including me in this program this evening. It came as a big surprise when he sent me an email that Lawrence would like you to speak at the conference banquet. So, oh my. In any case, I am really, really honored to be a part of the conference. This is one of the few gatherings we have here in Austin in which academia and policymakers come together to celebrate our common heritage. And kudos to Dr. Falola for making this possible over the last 18 or 19 years. If we would please give a big. It has been an interesting journey, to say the least. I grew up in Ghana and decided, after being an arts student, those of you from back home know, it's basically a liberal arts, A-levels, history, studied in Guanyin and rest. And I decided to go to college and gone and to change course into business administration. And I think about 7 women out of 7 years in class. Anyways, that was a very different trajectory for me, because I didn't know what I was getting into. And I found out there was a lot of quantitatives around the subject that I decided to major in, which was accounting. And so I struggled through it, and my thought process there was that if I'm going to be at this university, I better learn something I know absolutely nothing about. And accounting was for sure one thing I knew absolutely nothing about. So I took on a very contrarian attitude towards it. And little did I know that some 40 plus years later, I'll be here talking to you about my life in accounting, in practice, in industry, and the last 30 some years in teaching. It has been an interesting journey, and I would kind of digress a little, kind of show you how life places certain people in our lives that we don't really know how far that relationship will go. But for starters, whilst I was at the university, I met my husband, who who's on the faculty at UT as well. And then during my tenure on campus at the University of Ghana, there's a professor, Senyu Chim, who's here with us. He's all students, he was my senior. We walked the rounds in Accra with audit finals, doing internships with KPMG, Pitmawi at the time. And who knows, 40 plus years later, you know, our paths would meet in Florida and in Austin and here. And Isaac and Christina, other guests of mine, who have been ever so close to us the last 30 some years we've been in Austin. And Christina's dad was my dad's friend. I mean, it's just amazing how these things work. And then Miss Boyce and Sarah, my dad apparently was their doctor, and I didn't know that until we met here in Austin. But it's a small world, it's basically what I'm saying. A very small world. Anyways, so how did I end up at UT Austin some 25 years ago? I came to the US, you know, did graduate work and then proceeded to work in industry and then did some teaching, and honestly did not know I'd ever become a teacher. It wasn't part of the equation. But kids came along, and kids, as you all know, will change your direction. And when you get to a point where month-end closing comes in the way of doctor's visits for the children, like every month-end is a big deal. You spend hours trying to close the books and so on. And it became very clear to me that my two-year-old and one-year-old needed me more of a need. I had to make a switch, so I switched into teaching. And came to Austin. Roland was on the faculty at UT, and I was at Austin Community College, made it up there as the department head of accounting at the Rio Grande campus. I was comfortable doing what I was doing there. And I received a call in late 1992 from UT Austin's Department of Accounting, asking if I could join the faculty at McCombs. And the specific course they wanted me to teach is the course Every Accountant Remembers, because it's a lot of work, very rigorous, and challenging, to say the least. Challenging for both the students as well as the faculty teaching class. But anyways, so I said, well, a couple of things. Roland is on the faculty, same department, same business school. So the question was, do I really want to be on the same faculty with him in the same department? And I'm not sure whether it was just my concern. I think he was also my concern. But I was thinking about it. In any case, I did join the faculty in January of 1993. And as they say, the rest is history. But it has been a remarkable journey. Remarkable from a number of perspectives. It's been challenging. If you know anything about accountants, people who want to be accountants, the entire day, personalities, everything needs to take off. They'll argue for the next 1 point on a test. And so it was a lot of work. It was a lot of work. So it's huge commitment of time. And as part of that commitment, one had to be intentional in how one spent one's time. Because you had to stay current. The particular subject I taught was one that changed. The rules changed, the standards changed. You had to keep up. And therefore, my nights were long, to say the least. But most fulfilling, very good students, and excellent faculty. They're really, really smart folk. So that created the additional pressure to keep up, you know. But as I said, it was a time of making very good use of my time. At the same time, trying to balance family life with young kids and so on. The other part is that it was a hurried life. You had to be very efficient going through your day, make sure you were well prepared for class and so on. Now, as part of this management of time in a very hurried, fast-paced environment, it became very clear to me after reading a student's notes that I had to be really careful about the time I spent with my kids. Because you spend so much of your time on campus teaching so many students, and if you're not careful, you may be neglecting something that's important at home. And I say this because I had an experience with a student whom I had tried to encourage, you know, to be serious with their work. And she was kind of hesitant. So the semester was over, and then she writes me this note that her mom was a professor at some other institution, and she came away from the experience with her mom that her mom cared more about her students than she did her as her daughter. I said, wow, okay, Florence. Take note. So, for I presume most of you here are academics, most of you here may be professionals, and our jobs can be all consuming. And it was interesting getting this unsolicited piece of advice from a student about her relationship with her mom. So that was one of the incidental takeaways, but I thought pretty profound, given what we tend to focus and spend our life and time on. The next thing I'd like to say about the last 25 years here, it's been a time of tremendous growth, personal growth, understanding how to relate to people across the academic ladder, tenure track, you know, senior faculty, you have lateral positions, you have staff positions, there's a lot of management involved, making sure that you are thought of and considered relevant. Relevant not just to your students, but relevant to your peers. And so the question becomes, you know, how do you stay relevant? And a number of observations I made one, there's a saying my brother shared with me many years ago. He said, Florence, you have to be seen to be keen. You have to be seen to be keen. So I thought that was interesting. So basically, you have to show up. Folk need to see you at meetings. And they have to see you at maybe every places where they may not even expect to see you, but you have to show up. Now, showing up is one thing, but you also have to stay engaged. That's where the keenness comes in. You have to show passion and interest in what's going on in your department, folks' lives, you know, across departments, as a way of staying relevant. Part of it is, you know, the discussions that will take place about you at which you will not be present. And the question is, what gets said about you when you're not there? And a good part of it will be a function of how you have related to different people over the course of your career. And I say that, you know, oftentimes we spend spend time within our discipline or within our department, and may not take advantage of interdisciplinary activities that may come up. Just to give you an example, years ago, the MBAs were part of a global program where one of our professors wanted to start a, they go out for about 15 days to the sub-Saharan African country. So they had been to South Africa, and this was their first foray into West Africa. And he had put together a program where they would have the students read an African writer as a way of introducing the students to African culture, African history, and African thought. And so he approached me about this, and I said, okay, well, this is a book, incidentally, one of the first one was Saeed Bayama's The Beautiful Ones Are Not Yet Born. Some of you have read it, but I heard about it since I was in high school. I've never read it. We come to find out I read it here. I had to read it here in Austin to discuss with the students. And so when it came to the historical part of it, I said, well, my dear Prof. Alola, help me out, because I think you know, I'd rather you speak with authority on the historical aspects. And so we reached out, and so he became a part of that program, and also, you know, seconded other speaking students to come and help program, that it brought a relationship between, you know, accounting, business, and history. Subsequent to that, we looked at my first coup d'etat by John Mahama, another very good read. But I bring this up to introduce the importance of broadening one's perspective, because it's very easy to get pigeonholed in your department and its responsibilities. And that alone is plenty, don't get me wrong. But it helps over time if you can fit in something on the interdisciplinary side to broaden perspectives. So being seen, and secondly, being keen, being passionate, engaging, and hopefully being able to contribute to whatever the discussion is at the departmental level or at the university level. But in addition to that, I would also say that the time at UT Austin has been marked by not just growth from a personal perspective, but an understanding that we are all in this game together. We're all learning, and learning takes different forms as well. And one really never knows where we'll end up. That may be the most important lesson I have learned. We all take ourselves back. Let's start with 50 years ago. Let's just start with that. In some cases, 60 years ago. I'll give you a minute or so just to think. Who would have thought you'd be here today? Just think about the journey that life has provided and placed in front of you. And likewise, might as well expect so much of our students, you know. Who knows where they'll end up? We really do not know. And for that, we just need to find a way of doing our best in the moment and leaving the rest to what life has to offer. Certainly for me, the students said to me once, oh, Mrs. Santi, I said, you must have been very good in math, and I had a very good laugh when you said that. You haven't met my high school math teacher. Anyways, but can you overcome seeming difficulties, most certainly. We live in an age where you most certainly can. And so before I round up this little I just want to say it truly, truly is a wonderful honor that Prof. Mugabe extended to be part of this organization. It is most needed. As Africans, we have a lot to offer the world. We just look at things a little differently, but it all comes together. And I think any opportunity we have to live the positive parts of our culture, because we know there are other parts that need a lot of work. We certainly appreciate the forum that conferences like this provide for us to exchange ideas, identify challenges, attempt to get to solutions, and make the world a much better place. So on that note, I'd like to thank Prof and Madame for this beautiful occasion. I see the party started before we had dinner. Roland, thank you so much for 37 or so years, almost 38 years together. And my wonderful friends, Isaac and Christina, Sarah, Prof. Senior, for joining me this evening and for being a part of this remarkable journey. My very best wishes to each and every one of you. It works out in the end. But let's make the best out of the time that we have. Time is precious. The time to act is now, not tomorrow. My father would say no as a sense of urgency to it now. We have to continue to be tenacious as we pursue our various vocations. So with that, my very, very best wishes to each and every one.